there, this is Kevin Patton, and I have another helpful tip for teaching.
Hi, it's Kevin, and we're going to do some real basic and quick construction of some slides for teaching or learning using bullet points. And this is usually how your PowerPoint presentation starts out when you open a new one with a template there for a title slide. And I'm using PowerPoint 10, but this applies pretty much to other versions of PowerPoint and other presentation programs as well. And what we're going to focus on mainly is just really how to put together an effective slide using bullet points, not so much how the hardware works. Because the hardware and software work pretty much the same from one presentation program to another, one version to another. So let's go ahead and use this template, and I'm just going to click where it says click to add title, and we'll call this bullets, and where it says click to add subtitle, you don't really have to do that, but I'm going to. Bullets can injure you, or just injure, if not used safely. Okay, and that's true. We want to have effective bullet points in our presentations in the classroom or online. So, next thing is we need a new slide. So we're going to go up here to New Slide, and if we use this little drop-down thing here, we don't want another title slide. I think probably a good general purpose slide would be this one here, title and content. So we'll do title and content, and we're going to put up here our topic for the day. And you'll notice that down here in this frame, it says click to add text, and we already have our first bullet point there. So I'm just going to click where it tells me to click, and I'm going to put my first topic under this major heading, and then the next one I'll put my subtopic 1, and then I'll have another subtopic 2, and notice that I'm not capitalizing the first letter there. It's in lowercase when I type it. Let me do another one. See, it's lowercase, but then as soon as I finish that word, that first one is just automatically made into uppercase there, so subject 3, and then I'll have my topic 2 here, and then I'll have a subtopic or 2 for this one, subtopic 2. And you'll notice that this isn't arranged very well, is it? Because everything's at the same level. And I think, you know, one of the main points of using PowerPoint is to visually organize your points for the reader. If you're just throwing a whole list of things up there, it's not going to be easy for the listener to really see how it all hangs together. So one of the uses of PowerPoint is to be a graphic organizer, a visual organizer, and it's not being very effective right now in that regard. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go up here to my subheading 1, and I'm going to press the tab key, and now that makes it indents it a little bit underneath there, and I'm going to do that with all three subheadings under that first topic, and then I'll do the same, just press tab key, go here and press the tab key. And so now it's organized in a lot more understandable way. And maybe I have another topic that I want to add. So I'll add topic 3 there. And looks like it's going to be a subtopic of topic 2, and I don't really want it to be. So I'm going to go back over here, and I'm going to click Shift Tab. And so that's going to reverse the tabbing action and bring me back to all the way to the left side there. And so I'll go to the end of that one, just hit enter, and I'll enter another subtopic. And wait a minute, I don't want that to happen. I want that to be indented. So I'm going to hit tab. I shouldn't hit it at the end there, should I? Should go back to the beginning and hit tab. Okay, now see, it's a subheading. And now I'll go to the end, and I'm just going to hit enter to go to the next one, and look, it's automatically indented again into next. You know what? I'm going to go back for just a second. Notice what happens here. As soon as I start typing here, it's not fitting inside that little frame, is it? So as soon as I start typing, okay, it reduces my font size, so it'll fit in the frame. And I'll go to subtopic 2 and then subtopic 3 and see what happens when I do subtopic 3. It shortens it again, so I'll do another subtopic. So, oh, it's making it even smaller. So subtopic 4 there. Now you see what's happening here is that my font size is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So PowerPoint is allowing me to fit all kinds of stuff on this slide within this framework that they've set up for me. And so my margins are going to be really nice, but my font is going to be so small that I'm going to overwhelm the reader with too much information on one slide. Not only that, a lot of them are going to have a hard time seeing it, depending on how it's projected or how it's being viewed. So this really isn't ideal, is it? But let's do what we can with it. And tell you what, let's get rid of this whole topic 3 for the moment. And I'll show you what we're going to do with that in a moment. But let's come back here, and you'll notice that once I got rid of that extra stuff that it, you know what, I'm going to just go backwards here and put it back in there. Okay, let me show you this. One of the ways we can handle this, if we really, really want to have all three topics on one slide, okay, here's a way to get around it. We can enlarge this frame, and now things are going to get a little bit bigger. Here's another trick. See this title frame up here? We can move that up a little bit higher. That'll give us a little bit more room. As a matter of fact, we only have one line in there. We could probably move it up like that. And, you know, this isn't ideal to smoosh everything together, but if you really, really want to have all those bullet points in there and have them readable, then maybe it's not a bad idea to do this. Now, coming back down to our frame here, I'm just going to go over here and grab it and move it up to there. And now look at that. You know, the font size has gotten larger. Now it's not quite so bad. It's still, I think, overloaded with information, especially if each one of these is going to be a phrase or something. That could be a little bit iffy there, but that would be a way to handle it. That's a couple of ways for handling bullet points. Now, if you want to go back and add some other things, like think, oh man, under subtopic 1, there's actually 2 points I want to make there. So I'm going to call this point 1, and I'm going to call that point 2. So I can go in there and just keep adding more, and as we see, PowerPoint is just allowing me to keep on adding more and reducing the font size so it stays in my frame. Look at this, too. I'm going to go to the end of this one, and I'll just click on it. Now that's going to give me the same subheading, so I might want to add another subheading there, but I really don't. I want to indent that, so I'll hit the tab key just like I did before, and I'll put point 1 and point 2, and oh man, I'm getting into the same hot water here, aren't I? Because it's just getting smaller and smaller and smaller. So at some point, I'm going to want to break this up. As a matter of fact, I think it's probably a good idea to just take topic 1 and put it on its own slide. Cut out topic 2 and 3 and paste them onto separate slides. And I'll show you an example of how to do that in a minute. But right now I'm going to show you another common mistake that I've seen people do with PowerPoint slides that really is not good for the student. So I'm going to just add in here a slide like that. Now, this is from a neurobiology lecture. And it's all about local potentials. And oh my gosh, really? I mean, who is that going to work for? I mean, if you actually take the time to read through this, it makes some sense. But there are several problems with it here. One is it's just too much information in one slide. And not only that, it's presented in a way that really isn't conducive to a PowerPoint lecture. It's too many sentences. I mean, you don't want sentences. If you're going to be giving a lecture, you're going to be doing the talking. All you want to put on your PowerPoint are some key words and phrases to just kind of organize your talk for people, not give the talk for you. So if you really want all that detail there because you want to go back and review it before you give the lecture, here's a way to do it. Let's just copy the whole thing, and I'm going to press Control C to copy it, and I'm going to go down here, see where it says click to add notes. As a matter of fact, I'm going to slide that frame up just a little bit so we can see this area better. Where it says click to add notes, just click there and press Control V to paste it in there. And now I have all that information I had before. And I can go in and edit it within here if I want to make that easier to read for me. And you can print that out as a handout if you want for your students so they do have the wordy version of it available to them if that's really what you want them to have. But let's go back up here to the PowerPoint because that's really the problem. Notice there's no bullet points at all. And I think using an outline format really does help organize things. So to make it into bullet points, what we can do is just highlight the whole thing and then go up here to this little bullet point tab here. Now we're in the home tab. You know, there's these different ribbons we can select here. But if we click the home tab, that'll give us give us this ribbon where we have either some numeric or traditional outlines that we see there. You know, we do it by Arabic numerals, we can do it by Roman numerals, we can do it by letters, and so on. And it will automatically generate different levels. If we do subtopics, you know, we use the tab key to indent and so on. But I don't like using this kind of an outline style for PowerPoints in the classroom. And the reason is that the numbers and letters can be a little bit distracting. I think it's simpler and cleaner just to go over to this one over here, where we're using different kinds of bullet points. And again, you know, using these fancy bullets, I don't know, I think simpler is better. So let's just go with the standard one with plain old bullet points there. So that's the way you automatically make them into bullets. Now, they're all at the same level. So we have the same problem we had a moment ago. So how can we deal with that? Well, okay, we can start to do some indenting here. We can look for places where we can group things together. And we're going to do that in a minute. But before we do that, we have some other problems we have to clean up here. And you'll notice that there's all these little red squiggly lines here. And that's PowerPoint telling us we might have some spelling errors or some other kind of errors here. Like this one, ECT, what does that mean? It should be ETC. That's just a typo. I make these typos all the time. But you know what? You want to check for those typos, because if you don't, then you're going to be not only possibly confusing your students, but also you're going to show that you don't really care too much about presenting a nice presentation, that you don't care about being sloppy, so that when you expect your students to not be sloppy, they're going to say, yeah, but you are, or at least they're going to think that. And not only that, but isn't part of what we're trying to do as teachers is to teach our students that professional communications are important? I work in human anatomy and physiology, where most of my students are going into healthcare. If they don't learn how to be exactly right in their professional communication, that can literally kill people. It can cause severe safety problems. So I want to be very, very careful. And boy, it's easy to miss these. So PowerPoint highlights them for me. But you know what you want to do? And this is what I do, is I go back and check it a few times before I actually use the slide. If you have somebody that was willing to kind of proofread for you, that's even better. I do a lot of professional writing, and thank goodness for my copy editors and so on, who can find those typos that I keep missing, because they're really easy to miss. So we want to go through and check some of these, like decrementally here. That is spelled correctly, and it's used correctly, but look what I did. I capitalized it. Boy, that's not really proper grammar, is it, to capitalize that? That's not a proper noun or somebody's name or something. So we're going to go back and fix that. Now, PowerPoint still thinks it's not right, but, you know, it's just not familiar with that word. Depolarizations here, is that right? Yeah, sure, that's fine. And it's capitalized because it's at the beginning of the line there, and that's the format we're using, so no problem there. It's just a word that PowerPoint doesn't recognize. It's not in the dictionary. And there's a way to add it to the dictionary, but that's not the purpose of what we're doing right here. We'll learn that some other time. Now, what about hyperpolarizations? Yeah, that's spelled correctly too. I always want to double check that to make sure it's not a typo. But the problem with it here is that it's not capitalized at the beginning following our standard format. So I'm going to put that in there as well. Now PowerPoint's later going to tell me it's misspelled, but again, that's only because it's not in the PowerPoint dictionary. There's some other things I can do here that are going to help me. For example, sodium channels. Technically, those are sodium ion channels. And sodium is something I can, change to a shorthand version anyway, and it's probably going to help my students learn this. So I can do sodium Na+, which is the symbol. Now, Na+ by itself is not really technically accurate. And again, I'm trying to teach exactly correct professional communication. So I'm going to have to go up here and make that a superscript. So I'm going to check superscript up here, and now it's correct. And I can do the same thing with potassium channels down here. Now I'm going to change that to K plus, and I'm going to need to do the superscript thing here too, because I want to have exactly correct professional communication. So do a superscript there. And, you know, I can do that in a couple of different places. This is going to tighten things up for me and make it easier to read. So I'm going to do NA plus. You know what? I don't need to mess with that. You know what I can do? So I can just copy this. So I'll copy that. And I'll just paste it right there. And is there any other place I'm using sodium? Doesn't look like it. So let's do the same thing with our potassium ion. Let's copy it, and then we'll go down here to potassium, and we'll paste it. So now we're good to go. Okay, but boy, there's a lot more I need to do here to make this readable, isn't there? I mean, just reducing the size. So, boy, I tell you, if you start reading through this, you start to see that things are not really organized and necessarily in a very logical way. So here I have local potentials can be triggered by chemicals. They can also be triggered by sensory stimuli. So maybe the thing for me to do is I'm just going to make a new, let's go back there. Let's do my bullet point here. Okay, let's make this triggers. What are the triggers? Well, there are two kinds of triggers. I'm going to indent to this one, and I'm going to indent that one. And do I have to say they can be triggered by, they can be triggered by? No, I don't need to do that. I can get rid of this whole thing here. Get rid of that. Get rid of that. And you know what? I can do this even more. Reduce it even more. I can get rid of this here and just put a parenthesis there. And then put a parenthesis on the other side there. Because really, I would just want to say one trigger is chemical triggers. An example would be neurotransmitters. And I could talk about this. That's what I will be talking about in my lecture. What about sensory stimuli? That's the other major one. Do I have to put all these examples? Nah. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to put a couple in parentheses. Sounds, pressure. I'm going to get rid of all these other examples because I can just talk about those other examples, maybe even give more if I want to, and have a little discussion on what do you think some sensory stimuli would be. So boy, that has taken that whole set of concepts and made it a lot more readable. Okay, so something else about local potential is they're conducted in this unusual way, decrementally conducted. What that means when you say that we have decremental conduction is that they lose energy as they travel across a membrane. So these two bullet points are really saying the same thing. One defines the other. So maybe we should just get rid of that. And we'll just call this, whoops, we'll just call this decremental conduction. And we'll make this one a subheading under that. So decremental conduction, what is that? That means they lose energy as they travel across a membrane. As a matter of fact, just to simplify it a little bit, make reading fast and easy, we'll just say lose energy as they travel across a membrane. Okay, now there's different kinds, depolarizations and hyperpolarizations. These increase the membrane potential, these decrease the membrane potential. So maybe we want to put these under the same heading. So we're going to call, since one goes up and one goes down, we're going to say direction. We're going to say there's two different directions. And so we'll indent that one and indent that one. And so depolarizations, what are those? Those are increases in membrane potential. That is membrane voltage. So you know what we can do is we can just put a dash there. And we've already learned about membrane potentials and the fact that they're voltage. So we're going to say this. And we know starting point, our reference point, is resting membrane potential, and we know that that's RMP. So you know what I think we're going to do here is we're just going to make this a parenthesis, get rid of that one, and say above RMP, just to clarify, And of course, I probably wouldn't need to absolutely have that, but just to, you know, be extra careful. And we're going to do the same kind of thing over here. We'll just make that a dash. And we'll say decreases voltage. And we're going to get rid of all this stuff. And, oh, look, we were missing a closing parenthesis there anyway. That's a typo we missed before, isn't it? So we'll close that set of parentheses, and we'll put this below RMP. And so, wow, a lot cleaner. I think it's a lot more readable, and I think it makes a lot more sense. Now let's go down to these other points here. Opening of sodium channels causes the membrane potential to increase. Well, we just learned that causing a membrane potential increase has caused depolarization, isn't it? And so why don't we put that as a subheading under that? Let's get rid of that. Opening of sodium channels causes it to increase. So we'll take that and we'll get rid of it. We'll cut that out of there. And we will add a subheading here. We'll just glue it in there. Opening of sodium channels causes depolarization. We don't need any of the rest of this. Okay, until we get to the potassium channels. So we're going to get rid of that. And now we can say opening potassium channels causes the membrane potential to decrease. So we can get rid of that. We're just going to put that right under hyperpolarizations. So we've got to hit the tab twice. And oops, we better make that a capital letter there, shouldn't we? So, boy, we've simplified that and we've tied some things together in a nice, neat way. And you know what? This, therefore, the sodium channels causes depolarization and opening potassium channels causes hyperpolarization. We've already taken care of that. We don't even need this. That's just being redundant. And because these disturbances cannot travel far, they're called local potentials. Well, doesn't that fit better what we said up here about decremental conduction? So let's just take that and we'll cut that out of there and we'll move it up under here. And we don't even have to say all of that. We can get rid of local voltages because we said that we already kind of know that potentials and voltages are like that. So we can just leave it up there like that. Okay, now look at what we have. What we have now is a lot simpler than what we had before. And it's hung together in a way that makes sense. It helps students organize the concepts here. Now, if that looks a little scrunched together, there's a couple of things we can do. One is we can open this frame up a little bit, and that's going to cause the font size to get a little bit bigger. We can maybe move our title slide up there a little bit, scrunch it just a tad, and then we can increase the size of our frame up that way. So that's going to give us a little more room as well. Another thing that we might want to do is just get rid of this whole bottom part down here. Let's cut that. Control X, cut it. And so we're going to move this back down here. Whoops, not maybe that far. So that's going to be a lot less information on that slide to have to deal with. And what we're going to do now is just add another slide. We'll just put new slide, and we'll make it a another one just like we did, title and content. We'll go in to click text here, and we'll just paste it. So there we go. We just pasted our information in. And we'll put local potentials because that's the title we had on our previous slide. So when we play our presentation, we're going to see that, you know, we have our first slide. It's a little bit off kilter there. Sorry about that. And then our second slide. And so that's a lot better than what we had originally. So those are just a few ideas about using bullet points. And there's, of course, a lot more to learn. We can, you know, start animating these bullet points so they come in one at a time. We can start adding in some images and all that stuff. But this will get us started with just the basic ideas of bullet points and how to keep our slides from being hard to read.